Just before I came out, I was handed a prayer request that I would like to ask for this statement. And Chelsea Johnson, the granddaughter of Norman Colby Johnson, she is going to be having this test week. Father, thank you for how you are present and how you provide. Father, I pray I have the trust to live with you and to be a part of the Lord. You would give her not a spirit of fear, but a power and love just from where you have found her. And we thank you, Father, for the provision of your children. We pray, Father, that you can serve you today, Lord, and just trust you today. For those who are here, Lord, and have to God, and let's speak to you, Father, and let's pray. Take the grandparents to us. Thank you, Lord, with your courage and confidence for this day. Lord, there are many, many people in our church that are going through times of suffering, that are going through times that are even here, even this morning, that are not so scary, that are concerned, that can't stand. Lord, we get to ask that you to do the kind of thing that you would do to the world. And Father, we open the word and study it. Father, would you give us insight and understanding? Lord, would you help me to articulate as each of us understand with our critical and vital, our understanding to the Great Commission. In Jesus' name. Amen. We have been saying that life for all of God, wherever we leave our way, when we take the left off the fourth verse, I want you to listen to the fourth verse. My heart, my life, my all I bring to Christ in this mystery. He is my master. He is my Lord and King. Wherever he leads, I go. Did you think about the way those words are being said? Do you realize that was a statement that you were making? It was a covenant, a promise you were making to God. God, wherever you lead me, I go. Maybe it's the unconditional nature of that thing. It's not, God, wherever I want to go, lead the way. Wherever you lead, I go. That's a statement that we all have to take personally, but it's also a statement we have to take personally. Only the church can we really say, God, wherever you lead us, we'll go. If you lead us across the street, if you lead us across this nation, if you lead us around the world, wherever you tell us to go, God, we will go. Is that true of us? I pray that it is. I'm preparing that it is. I can tell you that it's not. Over the last couple of weeks, we've been really just putting this idea, wherever you lead, we'll go. Wherever you want us to be, God, we'll be that church. We will have the posture of, here I am, Lord, send me. That brings up the question, are we a dangerous church, or are we in danger? Are we a church that lives on the edge of faith? Are we a church that lives on the edge of faith? And don't really think about it. A church is either going towards God or they're going away from God. They're not sitting still. Either every day we're becoming more and more surrendered to Him or we're becoming less surrendered to Him. And yet we all know from Scripture that He wants to increase, but that requires that we decrease. And so it constantly brings up the question, why do we exist? Why is this church at this location? Why did God plant this church here 40 years ago? This anchor was celebrating 40 years of being in existence. Because a small group of people felt called of God to come and plant this church. Why do we exist? We exist like all people. Spirit, a meaningful relationship with Jesus Christ. We want them to know Christ. We want them to know who He is as Savior. We want them to know His will and plan for their lives. It's not just the people outside these walls, that's everyone inside these walls. The reality, though, is that our mission is no different than any other church since God established the church at Pentecost. This is the very reason the church of Pentecost started. God said, I'm going to empower these 12 guys. They're going to go into the world. They're going to start planting churches. And the mission of these churches is to have everyone experience Christ. If we are not seeking to engage people to Christ, if we are not setting them apart, if we're not sending them out, then we are not going to have a this is our church. This is why God is starting the church. The question is, how does this mandate affect God's church? How does the mandate of being a great Christian church affect us? Let me ask you a question. Why does Chick-fil-A exist? Does anybody know what their actual mission statement is? Do we have any Chick-fil-A people in here? They're all in the second circle. Well, this statement says something about we exist to glorify God. And that's awesome. But here's the reality. What do they have to do if they're going to glorify God? What's that? Sell chicken sandwich. Their job, every person that works at Chick-fil-A, it doesn't matter if you're a product like Matt Burton, if you're a VP, it doesn't matter if you're what you do. If you're not we're living for the purpose of taking that chicken salad and stick it in someone's mouth, then you've missed the purpose of Chick-fil-A. Now, I got to tell you, just to make sure I covered my bases, I made a phone call to three different Chick-fil-A employees this week. And that's the question, why you exist, and we all got to the point of, we exist to sell chicken sandwich so that we can eventually glorify God. I'm asking this question. How much time, how much energy, how many people, how much money do you spend at Chick-fil-A to get people to go eat at McDonald's? Don't you want them to guess how much money Chick-fil-A spends to get people to eat at McDonald's? Everybody, one time, one, two, three. Zero. Can you believe that? I mean, come on. They spend zero. Energy, trying to get people in the place. Do you know why we exist? We exist to help people come to know Christ as their Savior. We exist to take believers and grow them up in their faith so that they can go out into the world and be Jesus for the people. So, thank you. We are in the God business, not the good business. And as I tell you, there are way too many churches that they're doing the good thing at the expense of doing the bad thing. Why? Because it's easy to be good. It's politically correct to be good. It's socially acceptable to be good. You don't have to step on anybody's toes to be good. But the second that you decide to be about the Father's business, the second we decide that we're in the God business and not just the good business, it's going to change everything we do. It's going to change how we spend money. It's going to change how we employ people. It's going to change how we do preschool ministry, children's ministry, student ministry, adult ministry, senior adult ministry. It's going to change how we do music. It's going to change everything we do because we're not going to do it because it makes people happy. We're going to do it because it gives people Jesus. Does the Great Commission affect us that is Christ's response? How does the Great Commission affect you as a family? This isn't a question we can think about just one time. It's a question we must think about over and over and over and over again. Because it comes back to why do we exist? exist. First Baptist Church, 1840, exists to help all people experience an authentic and meaningful relationship with Jesus Christ. How are we going to do that? By helping them, by helping them honor God and His Word. Connecting people with Christ and His church. That requires that we share our faith. That requires that we share our family. That requires that everybody who walks onto our campus and everybody that walks off our campus to go into the world, that we understand that, that God is most important and that God is alive and active and free to move about in the lives of people in this world. No matter who comes into this campus, I don't care if they're poked about it. What do we do? Doesn't matter young, doesn't matter if they're older, doesn't matter if they're black, they're white, they're pink, they're purple, you name the color. We So we want to help connect Christ with the people of the Christ Church. We also want to grow believers to maturity in the faith. What does that look like? Someone, when they're mature in the faith, they're actually able to take responsibility for someone else's spiritual life. They're in the same role to see. The way I look at it, when my children are mature, they're going to be able to have children, feed those children, provide for those children, shelter those children. They're going to raise those children. The same thing happens spiritually. We have responsibility. Those who are spiritually maturing have a responsibility to take those behind us and invest Christ's faith into them. In fact, I cannot think of a higher responsibility if you consider yourself a spiritually mature believer is that you have someone that you're bringing along, giving Christ in you to them. And they did it by engaging people to serve them to Christ. We want to engage the world. Doesn't matter if it's working at the first pregnancy center, which by the way, I went to this week, unbelievable ministry. And there's a women's place where you're looking at. And if you're looking for a place to invest your life in something that matters into eternity, you need to come to this place and go down and serve at the Christ of Christ. God will give you a tremendous opportunity to make sure that you need to come to this place. Well, in the attempt, and I'm going to do this very fast, in the attempt to fill my heart with you, I want to look at what it really means to make disciples. Now, this is going to be no hard work. It's going to be quick, fast, but I'm going to try to, give you my heart as quickly and concisely as I possibly can. This will not be the first time that people ask me. In fact, everything in this message here, I have preached somewhere along the way. Now I'm just going to put it all in one message. In fact, I have a lot because as I was preparing, I really felt compelled to use the five points that I preached my very first sermon. Now, nothing else is just going to be there, but about the five points of it. Because it's about Listen to this out of Matthew 28. The disciples went to Galilee to the mountain where Jesus told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him. And then Jesus came to them and said, All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that commands you. Truly, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. In this, we find that we are called to be disciples who make disciples. That's what disciples do. Disciples make disciples. If you're a disciple and you're not making a disciple, then you're not a disciple. Did you get that? Disciples make disciples. Now, the question is, what is a disciple? A disciple is someone who experiences the love of God, who loves God, and wants other people to experience. The love of God. It's really that simple.
They understand that God loves them, they're adopted it, they fall in love with it, accept it, and then they want everyone else to accept it. Pretty simple. Pretty simple. But we see in this text really five things, and I'm going to do this quickly, so buckle up, write them down. In fact, if you've never written down one single word I've ever said, first of all, stay on you, but secondly, today is the day to do it. This is the day to take notes, if you're ever going to take notes. All right? First, a disciple is readily available to God. He is available to God. He accepts Jesus as Savior, and he listens and responds to the leading of God in his life. He's ready. He's on go. He's like, God, here I am. Send me. They finally went to Galilee to the mountain where Jesus was holding the door. I love this statement. I don't know who said it, but I love it. The greatest ability of any man is his availability to God. The greatest ability is his availability and his openness to God. So it doesn't matter how talented, gifted, wealthy you are. It doesn't matter how much God has blessed you with. Until we get to a place where we realize and we surrender and we say, God, all that you've blessed me with, I surrender to you. That's when you become of value to the work of the kingdom. But as long as we're using it for ourselves, as long as we're fortunate, we're not of spiritual value to the kingdom. And the thing is, if God didn't create us to give us earthly value, he created us for eternal value. He created us that our lives would honor and work for him. And so all that we have, all that I have, God says, would you make it available to me? Would you surrender to me? Second, I just want to have a section for them. It says, when they saw him, they worshiped him. See, our highest honor, our highest privilege, is to worship God. Our highest privilege is to put a smile on God's face. Now, I've shared this on many occasions. I can't even remember if I've shared this on a Sunday morning. I have to condone it. If I have, maybe there's someone here in the room that's never heard this, that need to hear this. Maybe for some of us, we need to be in the mind of the church. In Colossians chapter 1, verses 9 to 12, we find a prayer. This is Paul's prayer to the Colossian church. If you have your Bible, please turn it. I want you to look at this. Or look up on the screen. Paul says, for this reason, since the day we have heard of you, we have not stopped praying for you. We continually ask God, not once we ask, to fill you with the knowledge of his will through all wisdom and understanding, the Spirit gives. For what purpose? So that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and may please him in every way. The simplest way to explain it is the best reading I've ever read in this book, the best way I've ever taken this passage apart. It really means that God wants us to live in such a way that we put a smile on his face. That our lives are so honoring to him that we know him. Now watch this. Being fruit in every good work. Growing in the knowledge of God. Being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, that you may have endurance and patience and giving joyful thanks to him. In this text, we have two issues. We have what a good Christian is and what a God Christian is. Now, if I were to ask you, what is a good Christian? I've done this on different occasions, but what I typically hear is a good Christian goes to church. Would you agree with that? A good Christian does good things, good behavior, the moral. Would you agree with that? You realize I'm giving you, I'm drawing you in. You're getting ready to get a sucker for me. Let's say a good Christian tithes. They share their faith. They obey God. They trust God. We can go down this list, and we can list all the things. We can talk about things that when you're out in the world, you talk to someone, you say, what are the good Christians? They'll give you this list of things. What I want you to notice is Paul's prayer. Paul gives a list. He says, number one, they bear fruit in every good work. Number two, he says that they're growing in knowledge. Number three, that they're being strengthened with power. power. Number four, they have endurance. Number five, they have patience. Number six, they have joyful gratitude and thankfulness. What I want you to notice is, this is what we say is a good Christian. This is what Paul says is a God Christian. What do you see in common between those two? Not much. See, I think this is part of our problem as a church. We have been told that this is what Christianity is, and the Bible says, no, this is what Christianity is. And so we've been living a life this time that we're manufacturing. We're saying, oh, I've given my time. I go to church. We're all these things that we're doing, we're saying, this is Christianity. And God says, no, it's not. You've been duped. And some of us have been duped by the words that come out just out of a pulpit. Some of us have been duped by well-meaning people saying, this is Christianity. But folks, this is not Christianity. Paul prays, and let me explain this very quickly. Paul prays, what he's praying is that these people will be under the leadership and influence of the Holy Spirit. And when you're under the influence of the Holy Spirit, here's what happens. You bear spiritual fruit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, meekness, self-control. These are the characteristics of Christ in you, the Holy Spirit in you, coming out of your life. And the only way that happens is if you live surrendered to the Spirit of God who's willing to lead and talk and guide you. Growing in knowledge, great word, gnosko. G-I-N-O-S-K-O, I think it is. It means experiential knowledge. He's saying, I pray that because you are walking in spirit, that you are growing in your experience of God, that He becomes more and more real. That even though you can't see Him, He's a friend that's closer than a brother. He is so close to you, you know He's strengthened. He says, you're being strengthened. The word is literally in strength of the power, dunamite, dynamite. The word strengthened needs to happen over and over, that literally our lives are being prepared for by the power of God in us. There's a spiritual combustion in our life that moves us. Then he says, endure. Hupomeneo. Literally, it means that we are gaining power because we're under the influence of God, that we have brought ourselves. Hupo means to come under. Meneo means if we're in a miracle time, that we're lining ourselves up with Him. And so what we're doing, we get endurance, not from our ability, we get endurance because Christ has filled us with this presence of His strength. Because we understand His word. Patience. Wow, what a word. That's what the meaning. It literally means that we treat others the way God treats them, even when people treat us the way they treat each other. How is that possible? How can I be that patient in my ability? It's only Christ in me that gives me the patience to treat someone the way that God wants me to treat it, even when they treat us with contempt and revolt and rebellion. That is a spiritual thing. And then joyful thanksgiving. That because Christ is in us and living through us, we have this amazing gratitude because we're experiencing Him in the fullness of who He is. This is what Paul is praying, because he's saying, I want you to experience the reality of Christ, not some pre-sanctity. This all happens in the idea of an affection for God that we worship. See, worship is doing what we need, doing what we have. Third thing. A disciple respects God's authority. He leans on and respects the power of God. All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. This speaks to the abiding one. If I'm going to have authority, it's not my authority, it's Christ's authority. And the only way I have that is if I'm plugged into the Spirit who He is. I'm abiding here to bring this. If anyone abiding me and I'm here, He will bear much fruit. But apart from me, what it says, you can do nothing. So when I go back to the same thing, going through, I have to be plugged in. And the way I plug in is I realize that he's big, I'm small, I need him, he doesn't need me, yet he allows me to plug my life into him by faith. In the grace of Christ. And he gives me his strength, he gives me his power. I love this statement. It is impossible to live the Christian life in your ability. Anything less than Christ in me living through me is less than the body and life that Jesus has given us. Anything less. You know what the difference is? It's the difference between the church in Acts 1 and Acts 2. Have you ever read Acts 1 and Acts 2? Acts 1, they're sitting there waiting for something to happen. Now, they all know that Jesus has called them to go and make disciples of all nations. They've all experienced him, they've seen him, they've witnessed the resurrection, and yet they're sitting there. The name God says that. They're unfaithful. Do you know what the biggest thing Acts 1 and Acts 2 is? The presence, the power of the Holy Spirit, and the fact that they're open to him. They're living under his authority, living in his authority. And then all of a sudden, all heaven breaks loose. It's an amazing thing. God is at work. In fact, if you look, the result of Acts 2 is that at the end of Acts 2, the church has begun. I want you to catch this. You can't miss this. From the very beginning, God claimed that the church could not work without the Holy Spirit. Do you understand that? The church cannot function properly if it operates independent of the Spirit of God. And so if you're operating in the Spirit of God, if any church is operating in the Spirit of God, it's not a church. It's a gathering of people in a religious name. But it's not a church. The Holy Spirit, the power, the presence, the spirit of his approval, that is what gives the church its power and makes it a church. But don't miss it. For the church to have each one of us must be plugged into the Spirit of God in our own lives. The church is only trying to speak this way. Don't believe me? Read the passage of Scripture. Read what happened to the Israelites after the walls fell down at Jericho. Do you know what happened? God says, I want you to go, and I want you to do some of the stuff here. I want you to go and get ready for the next battle. And all of a sudden, they go out in the battle, and they get whipped. They get whipped. And a bunch of people die because one guy took some things that did not belong to him and buried them in his tent. They went to some little bitty country called Ai. Because of one person's sin. You don't think it's important that you walk with Jesus in this church? It is critical that you walk with Christ in this church. I don't stand up here and slap my bones every week because it's a convenient thing to do. I do it because I know that Christ in me, that my pursuit of Christ is critical to the life of the church, and that your pursuit of Christ is critical to the vibrancy, the life, and the ministry of the church. We cannot say that. That's the reason I need you and you need me. That's the reason you need this group over here, this group needs this group over here. It's because we require one another if we're going to first trust in Jesus Christ. The disciples looked at the agenda of God. words that happen to the Father who lives. Luke 19:10, Jesus says that God's agenda is to speak to the sacred world. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptize men in the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teach them everything I've commanded you, go on with you always, even to the end of the world. I've shared this with you before as well, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time here. Two types of people in the world. There are lost people and there are found people. That's it. Either people are saved or they're lost. Either people are going to spend eternity with Christ or they're going to spend eternity away from Christ. And inside of this, you have two types of people that are lost. You have those who are lost ones. That is, they either know they're lost and don't care or they've never heard. They're literally ignorant. And by the way, don't think because we live in the United States, don't think because we live in PCC or Georgia in the book of the Bible Belt that there are people who have never heard of Jesus. I find people all the time who really have never heard of Christ. Right here. Then you have the religious ones. Those are people that they think they're saved. They're religious, they're good people, but they've not put their faith in the resurrection of Christ. They've put their faith in their own interests. They put their faith in their religion. They put their faith in the church membership. And there are a lot of people that hear it. Then you actually have faith people. You have those who are carnal, that is, they're living a manufactured life. They're living the Christian life in their own ability. They're saved, but they're doing it in their own ability. And then you have the spirit-filled Christian. This is the same thing as we talked about just a minute ago in Christ's morning. This is what Paul tells us. That is Christianity. Anything less is a substitute. But make no bones about it. Every single person fits in one of those four categories. And it's been a long work time now, which I have time to do. But this is who you and I sit beside. Right now, you're sitting beside someone who fits in one of these four categories. What are you doing? There is a lost and needy family, or they're saved, and they even need to be spiritual, or they need to be spiritual. That's what you have. Now, here's the thing. When God says, I want you to go into the world and make disciples, he says, I want you to be incarnate. To be incarnate literally means God became incarnate, who took on flesh. God took on flesh. For us to be incarnational is that we model, we take on the character of Christ, and we show Christ by our life. We are his hands. We are his feet. We are his voice. We are his ears. And we take responsibility to make sure that other people see and hear that God's amazing gift. We share it, we show it, we say it. This is the statement. We're to take the word entrusted to us, and we're to invest it in others. We're to teach them everything we know to have experience in our relationship with God. We're to teach them how to obey. And let me explain how that works. I know that many of you have seen that. I've never tried to do this, by the way, before. When you look at the life and ministry of Jesus, what we see is that God did ministry. Jesus did ministry in four ways. First, he taught the ministry. We see all these scriptures where Jesus stands in front of a group of people and he just teaches and teaches. And people are drawn to him. And some people reject him. Then there was a group of people known as the 70. They were the people that followed Christ. They believed in him and they followed him. The third group were the 12. Which, by the way, did Jesus start with the masses or did Jesus start with the 12? Jesus started with the 12. And he spent one on one time with each of the 12. I believe, and I can stand on the authority of God's word to say this, that Jesus legal ministry this way. All four of these groups matter. It matters what the world hears about them. It matters that those who are following learn more and more about them. But Jesus pours himself into these guys. In fact, so much so that in John 17, I'm paraphrasing, Jesus basically said this: Father, I have done what you've called me to do. I can now go to the cross and die for people's sin. What is it that you have done so that people go to the cross? You have to take the cross. They were ready. They didn't know it, but they were ready to take the gospel beyond him. He spent more than one time with them. Let me explain the difference. This, I call this institutional ministry. This is relational ministry. Why am I sharing this with you? Because this is so critical to my heart. This is so critical to who I believe that God has called us to be. This is so critical to how we're going to evaluate why we're doing what we're doing and how we're going to move forward to the future. It's so critical because if we don't get this right, then we're going to be like every other church. Somewhere in the journey, we started doing ministry this way. Why? Because I can stand up here in three. I can stand in front of a surgical class, a group of 70 and 2, and never have to get my hands dirty. And all over America, all over the world, we're putting on popcorn parties and picnics. We're putting on dog and pony shows. We're doing things in God's name. And they're not all bad, they're not always good, but we're doing things that say, hey, if you want Jesus, come and get it. But we're not doing it. The gospel requires, if we're going to get it in the people's lives, if we're going to help them to discover a real Christ, listen carefully, that we're trying to get you to come and get it. Do you know why? Because people's lives are missed because of sin. Sin destroys, it kills, it creates muck and mess. And it would look worse in my garage yesterday when I started to work on it. Sin is not a friend. Sin does not do things that are good. And yet, all of us are sin because we're good. Every one of us allows a mess. And the only thing that can clean up our lives is the blood of God, the Jesus Christ. And so we've got to get away from doing ministry here, going this direction. The reason that's important is because we'll never get to you. We'll do all the big stuff, we'll do all the shows and everything else, but we'll never get to Jesus' message. And I believe that God is calling us to do. He's calling us to raise up a new generation. He's calling us to ask for the people in this church who are spiritually mature to start doing ministry in a different way. And that will start with the 12 and the 1 and move to the masses. I need bringing people here saying, you know what? These preschoolers, these children, these teenagers, I will make a personal investment. I will take 1, I will take 2, I will take 3, I will take 12. But it's going to become my spiritual responsibility because I am a mature believer. I'm not going to say, I've done my time. You don't do your time for Jesus. There is no retiring from Jesus. We don't work for retirement. We have boys and girls and teenagers. But if we feel lack of spiritual maturity by us, if we do not make an investment into them, they will stay in charge of the Christ that they have. We have many families who need acknowledge there's the realm of your throat, hopefully under their wings, and so let me walk with you. And the Bible teaches very strongly that those who are mature in the faith have responsibilities for those who are less mature. By the way, maturity is not measured by how old you are. You can be 9 years old and be spiritually mature. You can be 9 years old and need a teenager to disciple you. Just be honest. But we've got to take responsibility. And the way we do it is we're still, by the way, Jesus did this, Jesus did this, Jesus did this, Jesus did this. We're going to do it. We're not, by saying this, I'm not telling you that we're not going to have big events. I'm not saying that we're not going to have youth retreats and senior adult retreats. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is two things. Number one, we need to make sure why we're doing what we're doing before we do it. And secondly, it's got to be for the relationship. It can't be a thing to bring the comment to do it for life. It's got to be for the purpose of building relationships so that we can share Christ, we can help these people grow in Christ so that they will go out. Are you with me? One final thing, and that is the disciple relies on the strength of God. He waits for God. He wants to make sure that God's finger comes to the Father. He never moves out under the influence of God. He is looking. God, are you in this? God, can I see you in this? Do I see you moving? Do I hear you through the water? Because ultimately, what we're about is helping people to see God for who He is. I'm going to show you the video this morning. I love this video because this video really shows you not just the world's view, but God's view. But it shows you just what happens when the grace of God is experienced firsthand and how it really changes our perspective.
It can't force you to believe God's good. This is the one truth in the world. It's known as the prophet of peace. How can I believe God will use my life? I'm not certain to divide my life. Not again will I say Christ is risen from the dead. I will now more than ever in my life. And you can say it so. It is why there is ignorance within God and His prayer. Christians declare that without God, this world is all the darkness. This world can be made in my needs. It is a lie to say God will extend them to me. I'm not aware that no matter what I do, Jesus, He doesn't love me. I need to do what God is telling me. And yet, when I change my heart, I'm going to realize that God is helping me. I cannot presume that He's better than me. The truth is, no matter what I do, I cannot realize that God has always been with me. It is a lie to say that this world can be more than it needs. Without God, this world is responding to darkness. Christians declare that God is His prayer. You must realize that it's ignorant. I can save himself. I know now, more than ever in my life, that Christ is risen from the dead. Never again will I say that God has led me. I know the certainty that God will use my life. How can I believe that this world is a part of Jesus? This is the one truth in life. God is good. I can't expect you to believe God is good.
And I want to ask you this morning. Have you ever stood up and been accepted? And if you're believing, do you really believe that Jesus is going to be with you? Thank you. Father, we pray that you bless the church. Lord, we're so accustomed to sitting in our seats, watching someone else move. But Lord, can I ever believe that that's what's going to touch me to God? Because I'm going to bring you to the Lord. You are coming to me, everyone who doesn't know me. And you're going to worship me. Is to live in me, growing in me, and are you going out to the world for yourself? Father, I pray that the Lord will teach you to do this for all the things, whether we need to come to friends and brothers, whether we need to come to be committed children, or whether we need to help someone for the world to change our country. Father, let us to unite this church. Our offers are open. We love you.